Are you struggling to memorize pieces or practice scales?
Do you find yourself scrolling instead of practicing?
Do you struggle with performance anxiety?
Well, you have come to the right place.
Hi, I'm Andrew.
And I'm Angela.
And we are the hosts of the Musician's Toolbox.
On our podcast, we bring musicians from the music industry and we ask them questions about tools that they've used that have made them successful. And we fill up our own toolbox with our own set of skills.
Yes, and on this free, four-part, never-before-seen video series, we will be finding the answers to these questions.
The guests that you'll be hearing will include Mick Wetzel, a musician in the Los Angeles Philharmonic, Lito Hernandez, a multi-instrumentalist who has collaborated with Kanye West and Surfaces, That Viola Kid, a Juilliard alum and social media genius, and many more.
If someone sparks your interest in this video, please check out the full interview. Every Friday in December, we will be going through the steps to be a successful performer. In the first episode, we will be talking about scales. After that, efficient practice. Then, strategic memorization. And most importantly, performance preparation!
Merry Christmas!
Make sure you subscribe so you do not miss an episode of this four-part video series. And also, we post on different platforms like YouTube and podcasting platforms and Facebook and Instagram, so follow us there.
Anyway, we hope you enjoy.
Yes, and on to the episode.
Scales are one of my favorite things to practice, and I would say I practice scales in all and every way possible. It's one of my favorite place to be creative in the practice room. Slowly, mindfully, of course. And they can turn into anything that I want. So I play the violin. It's different than a keyboard instrument or percussion, of course. But for me, it can become a long tone exercise. It can become a tone sound production exercise, a vibrato exercise. And as I go faster, it can become a dexterity exercise. I can add rhythm to it. I can decide to work on the shifts. I can decide to do all sorts of bow exercises. I can do, one of my favorite way is to just do all major, minor, harmonic, melodic scales and arpeggios in the cycle of fifth, in adding some variations of bowings, articulation, rhythm, all of these things. I find that I really can have as much fun as I want in scales. And then once I've done all of this, I start practicing technique, repertoire. I feel so free and set and ready to go. So for me, scales are at the, you know, the basis of really setting a great practice session.
How long would you say you spend, how much time do you dedicate to scales in a practice session?
That's another great question. It really depends on how much time I have. Mm-hmm. I find that if I have a lot of time, I like to spend a lot of time on them. It really feels like a great workout when I'm done with scales. I feel so good. Mm-hmm. But if I'm short on time, I have a small regimen that I like to do, which is that cycle of fifth that I just talked about, where I start slowly and I go faster and faster. Once I reach a certain speed, then I stay at that speed and I go through the rest of the scales and mix in some bowings exercise. That can take about, maybe if I do all major, minor, harmonic, arpeggios, maybe 8 minutes total. Mm-hmm. And that would be really great right before an orchestra rehearsal, an opera rehearsal. They tend to be very long. But at the beginning of a practice session, if I have longer, I like to take, you know, leisurely time and take more time.
So practicing scales should just be part of the life of a musician. It's like waking up and having breakfast. It's kind of the basic ingredient to technique. We practice them for a number of reasons. One is to become very familiar with each key. Two is to develop good fingering habits. And if you can have perfect fingering on scales all the time, it'll make fingerings much easier to figure out in pieces. And then obviously we also practice scales as a warm-up and then just to develop better and better and stronger and faster technique all the time.
Right. Practicing scales is a part of my daily routine. And I have two systems that I use. One is sort of a hybrid of Carl Flesch. I grew up I studied with a Catholic nun, Sister Xavier Mary Courvoisier, and studied with her for 11 years, all the way through, you know, graduation from high school. And I was so blessed to have her in my life. She studied with Joseph Fuchs at Juilliard and had the best musical training that anyone could ever have. And what she was doing in Spokane, Washington, I have no idea. She was an extraordinary person and a phenomenal violinist and probably one of the best teachers I've ever had. And she was very generous with me and my family. We had very little, if any, money. And my parents drove me 150 miles round trip to my lessons every week, and huge sacrifice for my parents financially. And I only found out recently that she never charged my parents. I just have a huge amount of respect for her, and I believe there is a special place in heaven for her. But because of her training, my training was very rigorous, and I studied violin up until I was 24 years old, until after my mission, I switched to viola, and Carl Flesch all day, every day. And so that was everything, you know, in the violin, Carl Flesch, that's everything. The viola, Carl Flesch, the addition, there are some things missing, like fingered octaves, for example. But what I do now with my scale practice is I use Barbara Barber, and it's a condensation of Carl Flesch. And instead of being four pages for G major, G minor, it's two. It's two pages. And it's perfect. It's all that I need. And that includes thirds, sixth, and octaves intervals. And I have my own routine. So I go through that slowly for intonation. But honestly, I also do it for, as I mentioned earlier, endurance is a big part of my life. You know, the fatigue resistance, I call it. And then the other thing that I do is for speed. I'll do the scale, for example, 60 beats per minute. I'll do four per bow, eight per bow, four per bow, six per bow, eight per bow, 12, 16. And when you get to 16, that's fast. You're moving. Mm-hmm. And the cool thing is it's a nice filter, I guess, for tension. If you have any tension and you're trying to play 16 per bow, you can't do it. You just have to be fluid and circular with your motions, and your shifts have to be smooth, and your string crossings have to be round. Otherwise, it just doesn't work. And so I find it to be very refining to that kind of speed work. Yeah, and then I don't know if you want to hear the whole story, but I am also have invented my own scale system and practice, and it's really not mine. I used to get to my lessons. I studied with Paul Coletti for 5 years, and protocol, as you guys know, having studied with people, is you never show up to a lesson early. It's just bad form, right? But when I would get to my lessons 30 to 15 minutes early over to the west side, it's a, you know, it could be anywhere from a 30 to a 90 minute drive over there. I would text Paul where I would park, and I'd say, I'm here. If you want me to come in, I can. If not, I'm good. I can just read. And he'd always say, come in. So I would go in and I would listen to him warm up, and then blown away, I would go home and write down everything that I heard him do. And then I would take my sketches to the Philharmonic librarians, who are like magicians, and they would, they call it engrave it, you know, they would put it into Sibelius or Finale or whatever. And then I would take that to Paul and say, is this what you did? And his first comment was, you are such a nerd. What are you doing? Like, I love what you did, you know? And so from those sketches, I've come up with my own Coletti-esque scale system. And I alternate. So I'll do Barbara one day, Barbara one day, and my kind of Coletti extrapolations the next day. And they're both about 60 minutes.
I have a regimen of just scales that I cycle through. whether it's major, minor, like any form of the mode, or like I feel like an altered sound that I'm trying to work on, or like a diminished type of sound, whatever it is, I make sure that I just run it from the bottom of my range to the top of my range. And not top me stressing, but the top me just starting to reach. And that happens like constantly. And then whatever songs that I have to solo over, or that I have to like understand the harmony of it better, I will practice the scales associated with the chords in that song.
I practice scales when I'm trying to do improvisation, so I can get more familiar with seeing chord symbols and being able to have the hand frames and the digital algorithms for a better, you know, that's like literally the best way I could think about it, like quantizing large amounts of information, like hand shapes with major, hand shapes with minor, hand shapes with Dorian, Lydian, Mixolydian, they're all different. And just acquainting myself with that has helped me get better at making better choices for notes when I'm improvising. However, scales, I find just in a macro sense, are a really good template to practice technique, to practice something in the right hand, because the left hand is predictable. You know exactly what note comes next. You know exactly where it is. You can really dissociate away from your left hand, which is rare. We're often thinking about this. So it lets you get out of thinking about this and get more creative with this. The other boring thing you can do that is just play open strings. But come on, why would we want to do that? Like, we don't always want to play open strings. So that's the other side of scales for me. It's just like a template in a playground to practice different bow strokes and different groupings of notes.
I just have a follow-up question, because you say you've been focusing more on improvisation. As a classical musician, has your practice of scales changed because you're specifically focusing on improvisation? If it has, how is it?
I don't even know if I'm like a classical player anymore. I don't really play classical music.
Yeah.
No. What I think is really crazy is like, yeah, we think that like, I'm realizing that I'm just a violist. I'm like a string player, and I play classical music, but I also play hip hop, and I also play R&B, and I also want to really play jazz and be able to improvise. And the type of musician that I'm really working towards becoming is an independent artist. So like, my goal isn't really to be in the back of an orchestra section. I mean, I've tried that route and it's soul crushing. Like, I want to wake up and be excited to play my instrument every day. And I look to people like Masego and Kevin Olusala and D Sharp and my friend Brian King Joseph and all these other wonderfully gifted musicians, songwriters, and string players, and Masego plays all the instruments. But like, I really want to figure out what I can contribute to the musical culture as like an artist and a creator, rather than just like somebody who plays music by a dude who died 150 years ago. Yeah. He's dope. I like him. Brahms is lit. You can only play so much, so you're like, what do I have to say?
Oh, I practice scales in so many ways. and I have my students do their scales. Young students start with one octave and then two, and then we expand to four, which is standard. And we do scales in contrary motion, we do scales in rhythms, we do scales in thirds, tenths, and sixths, minors in three forms. And I typically practice my scales in all of those ways. Usually my warm-ups will be 6 to 12 scales every day as my warm-up, so I'll do them in different ways on different days and take different majors and minors. And it does two things. It helps your fingers maneuver around the keyboard better, and just even practicing your scales, you get more fleet-fingered and more accurate if you keep doing it. But it's also mentally just getting used to key signatures and what formations you're going to be using on the keyboard. and it's the foundation of everything that we do in Western music, so it's a vital step in any musician's arsenal to be able to do your scales and recall them at a moment's notice.
Can I put you on the spot?
Sure.
Do you mind demonstrating thirds or tenths or sixths in your scales?
Okay.
Since we have a piano here.
Yeah.
So these aren't parallel thirds or sixths. They're your hands. So normally we do scales in octave. So doing them in thirds is just a third apart.
Practice scales and all technical things with the idea of technique allowing me to express myself. So if the technique doesn't serve my musical goals, then it's not worth my time. But that being said, if my musical goals are not being able, if I'm not able to execute them because of technique, then that's something I need to address in my practice session. So when I practice scales, it depends on the moment. So I will focus on the technique that I need to focus on during that practice session in my scales. So scales are something that's comfortable, something that's familiar, where I can focus on bigger issues that I might be dealing with. So also, I'll use a drone very frequently and focus on intonation with scales. So.
Scales are so important, and so I don't spend a lot of time on scales anymore where I am in my career and where I am in my performing, but I remember taking piano lessons in high school. I did scales every day. Sometimes I wasn't as diligent as I probably should have been, but a lot of the time I would even just run through all of it, major, harmonic, melodic, just every key, run through them, and then I really could feel a difference in the control in my fingers when I would try to play my pieces after I had done that. And it was, I mean, sometimes it was even a literal warm up where if your hands were literally cold and you'd go through your scales like that, and then you can feel the warmth like creeping into your fingers and it's not so cold anymore. So scales, I don't think can be overemphasized, especially in, well, I'm a pianist, so I just talk about piano, but because it's the basis of everything. It's your knowledge of the geography of the keyboard. You know, any piece that you play, do you know that key? Do your hands know that key? They know the feel of that key. It's your harmonic basis. Can you tell what key you're in because you're familiar with all of that? It's also, you know, are your fingers, do they have the capacity to play completely evenly or to play a dynamic that goes like this? And those little fine motor skills, those are what you're developing when you work on a scale to play it evenly. Or if you, you know, anything that you do like that, it's all connected to your scales and how that works with your mental and physical playing.
So now I have to ask a follow-up question, which we might not include, but do you, you said like that was when you were a student. When did you phase out of how you practice scales, and how is it different now as a professional musician?
That's a good question. So it's not that I don't play scales anymore. It's that I don't most of the time, because it has more to do with the time management. Mm-hmm. I don't work on scales anymore.
I see.
So that's more of what I was trying to say. I almost always still start a practice session with at least a couple scales. If I don't feel like I have the time or the energy to go through the whole gamut of, you know, three in each key, then I won't. But there's I almost without fail still play some scales at the beginning of a practice session every day. It's just that I don't work on them anymore. I don't spend time trying to develop them just because of time constraints.
Thank you so much for watching, Angela, and I really appreciate it. And we're also super grateful for all these wonderful guests that we've had on the podcast and also on this video series. And once again, if someone said something that was particularly interesting to you, I'll leave the links to their full interviews in the comments or in the description down below, depending on where you're watching this from. So they should be pretty easy for you to find. And we are also looking for some new people to have on the podcast. So if you know someone or you think someone would be interesting to talk to, we would love to hear about them. You can contact us on our social media or on our website, or we have an email, so you can contact us there. And once again, we are so grateful for you, and we hope you have a wonderful holiday season. See you next time. Thank you.